and then it will also then not be able to be broken down and be synthesized. So fatty liver disease, obesity, adrenal insufficiency, impaired iron homeostasis, which can lead to kidney failure, and we're seeing kidney failure among the agricultural workers in multiple places around the world, in Central America and in Sri Lanka and in India. They're finding kidney failure for workers that are working with glyphosate on the farms. Insulin resistance and diabetes, cancer, and autoimmune diseases. So that's quite a list. And so now we're gonna, first of all, defend this idea of glyphosate getting in on the basis of other examples. Well, first of all, this, which is a paper that just came out. I was delighted to see this paper, looking at glyphosate effect on the rhizosphere. That's the area of soil around the roots of the plant. And they used a sophisticated RNA sequence analysis to find out which proteins were being expressed and which ones were being suppressed in the presence of glyphosate. They found lots and lots of changes, but a critical thing they found was increased production of the enzymes that are involved with making proteins and increased production of the enzymes that are involved with breaking proteins down. And what that means is that they're finding the system works so that the protein making machinery is somewhat careless. So it makes a lot of mistakes, and then if it doesn't fold correctly, it just says, okay, we'll just take that apart and build it again. That's how the system works. But if you've got lots of glyphosate getting in the way, you're going to have lots of cases where you make a protein that didn't work, and now you're going to have to be spinning your wheels, breaking it down, making it again, breaking it down, wasting a lot of energy producing proteins that don't work, and that's why you would increase the level of these enzymes. I found some very interesting stories about other examples of toxins. These are natural toxins produced by plants or by fungi that work by substituting for a known amino acid with a fake one. So this is fascinating, the story about an epidemic in ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease in Guam, which occurred after World War II, and they found there was a natural toxin that was produced by these cicads, which these people were eating, called BMAA. And it's a non-coding amino acid. It's an analog of serine. So that's another one of the amino acids. Just like glyphosate is glycine, BMAA is a substitute for serine. And that causes, for example, a defective version of the glutamate transporter, which has been linked to ALS. And that transporter has an essential serine-rich region, which will get messed up if the serine is replaced. Another example is multiple sclerosis and sugar beets. Sugar beets contain an analog of proline, which is called A's. And they have found that the people who live near sugar beet plants, sugar beet farms, have higher rates of multiple sclerosis than other people around the world. In Japan, in Europe, here in Canada, in the United States, they've seen this correlation between living near sugar beets, which may mean eating sugar beets, but also eating animals that ate sugar beets, because we feed the sugar beets to the animals, so you can get this toxic amino acid into your system, and then it will mess up all the proteins that contain proline. And so, for example, myelin basic protein contains a cluster of proline residues that are absolutely essential for it to work. If those are substituted with A's, then the myelin basic protein doesn't work, and you get in trouble with the myelin sheath. And here's a third example, which is a non-coding amino acid called L-cannabinine. Really fascinating story about this guy, Chris McCandless, who went into the Alaskan wilderness in 1992, and a book was written about his story. Towards the end of his life, he was eating the seeds of a wild potato plant that grew in the Alaskan wilderness, and those seeds turned out to be contaminated with this natural L-cannabinine, which eventually caused him to have to die of starvation because it messed up his metabolism. So that's three examples. So glyphosate is just part of a collection of amino acids that have this property. So here's the story with the sugar beets, glyphosate, multiple sclerosis, and mad cow. Quite a fascinating story that we've been working out. Mad cow disease is also called bovine spongiform encephalopathy, kind of a big word. And this is something that happened to the cows in Great Britain. They were being fed cow hearts, they were being fed cow brain in their feed, and they were getting poisoned by the whatever proteins were in these non-properly folding proteins that were in the brain, and so it's related to some other nasty diseases that humans get, like Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, and there's also Kuru. So there's this was popularized during that period when we had all that fear about mad cow. So cows are fed actually large amounts of sugar beet pulp, which is a residue from sugar processing. So when you pull the sugar out of the beet, you're left with this pulp. and they put that into the cow's feed. And so that could be a causal agent because of this problem of the proline. And so I found this article from 1986, which was talking about using dried molasses sugar beet pulp to feed to the cows. So clearly they were doing it back then, right around the time that they started getting this mad cow. So they eat this sugar beet that has this nasty amino acid in it, and then it gets into their brains, and it becomes, and then they eat the brains and reinforce it, so you get a higher concentration, and eventually it takes the cow down with something that is sort of like multiple sclerosis. Well, it turns out that root rot is something that occurs in sugar beets, and that glyphosate increases the risk. So glyphosate can cause a problem of this fungus infection in the roots in the sugar beets. And AIDS has been shown to have antifungal properties. So you might imagine, and this has not been tested, so I'm just guessing, I would love to find out, but it may be the case that the sugar beets that are being exposed to Roundup, the GMO Roundup Ready sugar beets, have a much higher concentration of AIDS because of the fact that they're fighting this fungus infection. It would make sense. So there may be a worse problem with the sugar beets, the GMO sugar beets with AIDS than there is with non-GMO or sugar beets that are not exposed to glyphosate. Then there's also a connection to particular microbes that are resistant that actually can metabolize glyphosate. And so amazingly, I found a paper that talked about they were looking for microbes that could fully metabolize glyphosate. That's a good thing to have because you can get rid of it that way. If you've got one of those microbes growing in your body, it can clear the glyphosate. And that CP bond in glyphosate is very difficult to break, and most microbes can't do it. So this article talks specifically about two that could. And those two turned out to be exactly the same two that were talked about in a paper that said these were the ones that were found both in the cows that had mad cow and in humans with multiple sclerosis, as well as type 1 diabetes and celiac disease. All of these diseases are going up in step with glyphosate usage on corn and soy crops. So it's very tempting to say there's a whole complex thing going on here with the sugar beets, with the glyphosate, and then these two microbes growing and flourishing and metabolizing the glyphosate, but putting some of it into their own proteins. So now you've got glyphosate contamination and proteins that are getting into our system. And then those proteins match. There's something called mimicry. When you get an antibody to a protein from a microbe that closely matches a protein in your own body, you can develop an autoantibody to that protein in your own body. And that's what they think is going on here in this paper. Very fascinating that Acinetobacter, for example, is making a protein that has glyphosate in it, and as a consequence, it can't be broken down. So then your body reacts to it with antibodies, and then if that gets into your brain, and this microbe infects your nose, so it's pretty easy to imagine it could get into the brain, and then you get you get immune cells in the brain responding to this microbe protein that's got glyphosate in it, and then in turn responding to the myelin basic protein to cause inflammation of the myelin sheath. So really nasty possibility going on there with these autoantibodies derived from the antibodies to the microbe proteins that have glyphosate contamination in them. So that's my hypothesis. Microbes are exposed to high levels of glyphosate. They incorporate into their proteins by mistake. That gives impaired proteolysis. You can't break it down. Antibody development and then autoantibody as a consequence. So very interestingly, in another paper that I found, or maybe it's the same one, they showed the actual sequences that were similar between the Acinetobacter and these two different proteins that are considered to be connected to multiple sclerosis, MOG and MBP. MBP is the myelin basic protein, and the other one is an oligodendrocyte galactoprotein or something. I forgot exactly what that stands for, but those two proteins have sequence similarity, which is what causes the mimicry that gives you the autoantibodies, and every single one of these has a glycine in it, so it's very suspicious to me that glycine is the problem causing this reaction. Okay, collagen, arthritis, and vaccines. I told you, I think gelatin has 25% of the protein in our body is collagen. So that's a huge portion of the protein in our body. And collagen has a huge amount of glycine. I think it's 25% of collagen is glycine. So you've really got a lot of chances for glyphosate to get into the collagen. It forms these triplets with glycine as the first one. And then the third one, the other two are often prolines. You've got a possibility for proline getting messed up by AIDS from the sugar beets as well. So glyphosate substitution for glycine. will mess up the triple helix, so the collagen won't perform the way it should in the joint. Gelatin is derived from collagen, and that's typically from collagen that's in the ligaments that are sourced from cows and pigs, and those animals are fed high doses of glyphosate in their GMO Roundup Ready feed. So you can imagine there would be lots of glyphosate in the gelatin. So you start then to worry about things that contain gelatin, things like gelatin capsules for your pharmaceutical drugs or your nutraceuticals, Jell-O. You know, you've got gelatin in makeup or in vaccines, and the vaccines is one that really, really concerns me right now. I'm concerned about the possibility of gelatin in the vaccines contaminated with glyphosate and resulting in glyphosate-contaminated vaccines. So MMR, flu vaccine, and rabies vaccine are grown, are live virus grown on gelatin that's derived from the ligaments of pigs, and the pigs have fed a heavy dose of glyphosate in their feed. The gelatin contains significant amounts of glycine and also glutamate, which is the neurotoxin that I mentioned before, and that glyphosate disrupts its, your ability to detox the glutamate because of the manganese problem. And so glutamate and glycine together work as a team to excite the NMDA receptors. And NMDA receptor, excessive NMDA receptor excitation can lead to neural burnout. So you can destroy your neurons with too much excitation from these two amino acids. And so we could also have glyphosate substituting for glycine and working to excite the NMDA receptor because it is a glycine mimetic. And so this is a worrisome idea to think of these things getting into the brain of a child, particularly if that child's been exposed to glyphosate in their food and they have a leaky gut barrier and a leaky brain barrier. The glutamate and the glyphosate will easily get into the brain to cause this damage. Interestingly enough, there's three plots here that are well correlated. I've talked already about children with autism and glyphosate application. These are two different, these aren't quite the same plots as what I showed before. This is the CDC's numbers for autism, and the glyphosate is not integrated over 4 years, it's just the individual numbers each year. But those two curves are already quite well correlated. The red is the children, and the blue is the glyphosate application on the core crops. The yellow curve is simply a count of the number of reports in the VARS database, Vaccine Adverse Event Reporting System, put out by the FDA every year, going back to 1990 on the left and up to 2010 on the right. And what's interesting is that the yellow curve is also going up in step with both autism and the glyphosate. All three of these curves are matched. So we don't know whether there's, you know, whether there's a causal relationship here, but what I'm suspecting is that over time, it's more and more likely to get glyphosate into the vaccine, which will then cause the vaccine to be much more toxic, and that's why you get this increase in the reports, number of reports. And in fact, you see it's very sharp. There's a really sharp rise right there around 2006 of the vaccine, number of vaccine reports. 2006 was when they introduced a glyphosate salt formulation. It was probably was designed to be more toxic to the plants and probably was more toxic to the humans as well. So I did some studies on the MMR vaccine from the VARS database, and I looked at the number of adverse reactions, the symptoms of the adverse reactions before and after the midpoint. So I just took the early data, equal time, the late data, and counted up the number of cases where certain symptoms were occurring. And these numbers are based on a subsampling of both sets so that I have exactly the same number of kids in each age group. So I sort of normalized for age, normalized for count, and just looking at the relative number of events. And you find that there was only one symptom that was more common before the early data was joint pain. And there's a lot of symptoms that were more common in the later data, including hospitalization, seizures, autism, eczema, facial swelling, anaphylactic shock, a lot of nasty things. Hospitalization here is 6 times more frequent, and it's actually worse than that because it's actually 50% more data. So it's 9 times as many in raw count hospitalizations in the later data compared to the early data. Something is making MMR more toxic than it used to be. So these are symptoms are all features of characteristics of allergies to monosodium glutamate, which is therefore a glutamate allergy. And so you could expect that it could be the glutamate in the vaccine that's causing these symptoms, working synergistically with the glyphosate to excite the NMDA receptors. And in fact, here's a paper on glyphosate and glutamate showing that that the acute exposure